Welcome to the outdoor chapel in Katie's garden. What a perfect place to celebrate the Mass on the World, written by Teilhard de Chardin, a Jesuit priest, professor of geology, and director of the National Geological Survey of China. On Easter Sunday in 1923, Teilhard sat writing under a tree in the desert of Inner Mongolia. As the sun came up, Teilhard wrote, "Over there on the horizon, the sun has just touched with light the outermost fringe of the eastern sky. Once again, beneath this moving sheet of fire, the living surface of the earth wakes and trembles." Further on in his essay, he wrote, "With neither bread nor wine nor altar, I, your priest, will make the whole earth my altar, and on it will offer you all the labors and sufferings of the world." Then, having recited the words of consecration in his meditation, he exclaims, "It's done! Once again, fire has penetrated the earth. At the touch of your word, the immense host, which is the universe, is made flesh. Through your incarnation, my God, all matter is henceforth incarnate." All the universe is incarnate. This Maundy Thursday, the day on which we traditionally recognize the work of Jesus the Christ to make his real presence known through bread and wine, we find ourselves physically separated from each other without Eucharistic bread or wine. Therefore, we cannot think of a more appropriate way to mark this Maundy Thursday than by celebrating with Teilhard in his Mass on the World. So join with us wherever you are in God's grand creation and rediscover that in the resurrection of Christ, all the universe is indeed sacred. This Mass is designed as a participatory event. A full bulletin, including your part, is available at edfw.org. As we begin, I invite us to pause for a moment and remember who we are and whose we are.
The collect for the celebration of the Holy Eucharist on Maundy Thursday reads as follows, and let us pray it together. Almighty Father, whose dear Son on the night before he suffered instituted the sacrament of his body and blood, mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully in remembrance of Jesus Christ our Lord, who in these holy mysteries gives us a pledge of eternal life, and who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. The Catechism in the Book of Common Prayer states this about sacraments. It says, "Sacraments are outward visible signs of inward and spiritual grace, given by Christ as sure and certain means by which we receive that grace." For 2,000 years, Christians have experienced God's grace in and through these sure and certain means called sacraments. We believe in God's action in and through all sacraments. We believe furthermore in the real presence of Christ in the celebration of the Holy Eucharist in particular, that Christ is made present in the event itself, and that in some mysterious way, Christ is present in the particular consecrated elements of bread and wine. On the night before Jesus was handed over to suffering and death, Jesus took bread, gave it to his followers, and said, "This is my body given for you." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave it to them, and said, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. This is my body. This is my blood." As Anglicans, we are not inclined so much to explain how Christ is present in the Eucharist, but we do believe in the mystery of the real presence of Christ. Throughout history, Christians of all stripes around the world have given up a Sunday morning to gather together, to hear the sacred stories of our salvation history, to pray together, and to approach a table or an altar to receive a piece of bread and a sip of wine, believing this is more than bread and wine. We not only believe it, we have experienced God's grace and presence in and through these sure and certain means. And now, in the midst of this novel coronavirus pandemic, most Christians will not gather in person to participate in the liturgy, which reveals and expresses that we are one body. The liturgy which reveals and expresses God's vision of holy communion with God and one another. The liturgy which is the source of sure and certain means of God's grace and presence. And this is especially disappointing in this holiest of weeks. Now, without denying or making light of our deep sense of loss in this moment, I would like to remind us of what we know already. That while it's true that Christ is present in consecrated bread and wine, Christ is not contained by these elements. Present, yes, but contained by, no. Christ is present in the reserved sacrament in your church ombre or tabernacle, yes, but contained within, no. Christ present in our consecrated buildings, yes, but contained within, no. Present in and through the living members of the body of Christ, yes, contained by, no. Present in and through God's creation, yes, contained by, no. The sacraments are sure and certain means by which we receive God's grace, but not the only means, not the only ways we encounter God, and we know that. I have doubts that Jesus instituted the Eucharist, or the Mass, or Holy Communion, or the Divine Liturgy, or the Lord's Supper, or whatever we happen to call this sacred meal, so that it would be the only means to know God's grace and presence. And I wonder, actually, if he instituted this meal so that we would see God's grace and presence, God's grace and presence everywhere, that our eyes would be opened to the reality of God's presence and God's action in and through all creation. And William Temple, a 20th century Archbishop of Canterbury, a theologian and a philosopher, he claimed that the universe itself is sacramental, that the universe is an outward visible sign of God's grace and presence. Richard Rohr, a Franciscan monk, claims that the first incarnation is creation itself. He's not the first to make this claim, but he says it beautifully. He says, most of the world's religions claim something like this. Everything that exists in material form is the offspring of some primal source which first existed only as spirit. This infinite primal source somehow poured itself into finite visible forms, creating everything from rocks to water, plants, organisms, animals, human beings, everything we can see with our eyes. He says that this first self-disclosure of God into physical creation was actually the first incarnation, long before the personal second incarnation that happened with Jesus. So Christ is embedded in all things. The Holy Eucharist is being celebrated all over the world tonight as Christians remember the holy night of the Last Supper. And yet most Christians will not be able to gather for this celebration in person, nor receive the consecrated elements of bread and wine. As we recall the very night on which Jesus commands his disciples to love one another. We will love one another by distancing ourselves physically, a sacrificial act of love indeed. So, some of us thought we would offer a liturgy that we find meaningful, if not profound. It is taken from the work of a French theologian, a Jesuit priest, as well as a scientist and a paleontologist named Teilhard de Chardin. As the story goes, in 1923, Teilhard was working on an extended geological exploration in the deserts of China near Mongolia. As a Jesuit priest, it was his desire and his obligation to offer Mass, but he had no bread or wine, much less a paten or chalice. His thoughts turned to the radiation of the Eucharist, the Eucharistic presence of Christ in and through the universe. And in a vision, he realized that he could lift up the whole earth as his offering. Cynthia Bourgeau writes, he began to see that the body for the bread would be the body of toil that humanity lifted up that day. The wine to be poured into this universal goblet would be the fruit of it, the fruit of labor, including the suffering. His meditation, his prayer, his vision is entitled The Mass on the World. To be clear, Teilhard, the priest and scientist, believed in the efficacy of the traditional Mass. He said that he was preoccupied with giving his daily Mass, which he called a cosmic function with a planetary dimension. He writes, when through the mouth of the priest says, "This is my body," these words extend beyond the morsel of bread over which they are said. They give birth to the whole mystical body of Christ. The effect of the priestly act extends beyond the consecrated host to the cosmos itself. He says, the entire realm of matter is slowly but irresistibly affected by this great consecration. Around the world tonight, the few gathered in person for the celebration of the Holy Eucharist will join their voices with most of us through the science of technology, along with the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory." May those of us gathered tonight, whether in person or through the World Wide Web or through our participation in the Mass on the World, be inspired to join angels and archangels and all the company of heaven and sing, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory." And may the whole world know that God's love for us is sure and certain.
I am sure I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Yes, I shall see the goodness of our God. Hold firm, trust in the Lord.
I am sure I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Yes, I shall see the goodness of our God. Hold firm, trust in the Lord. I am sure I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Yes, I shall see the goodness of our God. hold firm, trust in the Lord.
The Offering.
Over there on the horizon, the sun has just touched with light the outermost fringe of the eastern sky. Once again, beneath this moving sheet of fire, the living surface of earth wakes and trembles and begins its fearful travail.
Since once again, Lord, here in the steppes of Asia, I have neither bread nor wine nor altar. I will make the whole earth my altar, and on it will offer to you all the laboring and suffering of the world. I will place on my paten, O God, the harvest to be won by this renewal of labor. Into my chalice I shall pour all the sap which is to be pressed out of this day from the earth's fruits. My paten and my chalice are the depths of a soul laid widely open to all the forces which in a moment will rise up from every corner of the earth and converge upon the Spirit. Lord, grant me the mystic presence of all those whom the light is now awakening to the new day. One by one, Lord, I see and I love all those whom you have given to me to sustain and charm my life.
One by one, I also remember those who make up the other beloved family, which has gradually surrounded me. Its unity fashioned out of the most disparate elements with affinities of the heart of scientific research and thought. Again, one by one, I call before me the whole vast anonymous army of living humanity, those who surround me and support me, though I do not know them. Those who come and those who go. Above all, those who in office, laboratory, and factory, through their vision of truth or despite their error, truly believe in the progress of earthly reality and who, today, will take up again their impassioned pursuit of the light.
All the things in the world to which this day will bring increase, all those that will diminish, and all those too that will die. All of them, Lord, I tried to gather into my arms so as to hold them out to you in offering. This is the material that you desire, nothing less than the growth of the world born ever onward in the stream of universal becoming.
Receive, O Lord, this all-embracing host which your creation offers you at this dawn of the new day. In this formless mass, you have implanted an irresistible desire which makes us cry out, believer and unbeliever alike, Lord, make us one.
Over the earth.
My God, I know myself to be irremediably less a child of heaven than a daughter of earth. Therefore, I will this morning, climb up in spirit to the high places, bearing with me the hopes of all. Upon all that in the world of human flesh is now about to be born or to die beneath the rising sun, I will call down the fire, fire the source of being. We cling so tenaciously to the illusion that fire comes forth from the depths of the earth.
But in the beginning was power, intelligent, loving, energizing. In the beginning was the Word, supremely capable of mastering and molding whatever might come into being in the world of matter. In the beginning, it was not coldness and darkness. It was the fire. You, my God, are the inmost depths, the stability of that eternal milieu, without duration or space, in which our cosmos emerges gradually into being and grows gradually to its final completeness as it loses those boundaries which to our eyes seem so immense.
Everything is being. Everywhere there is being and nothing but being, saved in a fragmentation of creatures and the clash of the atoms.
Blazing spirit, personal super substantial fire, be pleased once again to come down and breathe a soul into the newly formed fragile film of matter with which this day the world is to be freshly clothed.
Radiant word, blazing power, you who mold the manifold so as to breathe your life into it, I pray you direct and transfigure the earth, which I have gathered into my heart and now offer you in its entirety. Remold it, rectify it, recast it down to the depths from whence it springs.
You know how your creatures can come into being, only like shoot from stem, as part of an endlessly renewed process of evolution. Oh, perfect every living thing, which needs to spring up, to grow, to flower, to ripen to this day. Say down the words, this is my body. And over every death force, which waits in readiness to corrode, to wither, to cut down, speak again your commanding words, which express the supreme mystery of faith. This is my blood.
In the earth.
It is done. Once again, the fire has penetrated the earth. Without earthquake or thunderclap, the flame has lit up the whole world from within. All things, individually and collectively, are so penetrated and flooded by it. From the inmost core of the tiniest atom to the mighty sweep of the utmost universal laws of being, that one might suppose the cosmos to have burst spontaneously into flame.
In the new humanity which has begotten today, The Word prolongs the unending act of His own birth. The great waters of the kingdom of matter have, without even a ripple, been imbued with life. No visible tremor marks this transformation, and yet, at the touch of your word, the immense host, which is all the universe, is made flesh. Through your own incarnation, my God, all matter is henceforth incarnate.
Through the consecration of the world, what my mind glimpsed through its hesitant explorations, what my heart craved with so little expectation of fulfillment, you now magnificently unfold for me. The fact that your creatures are so linked together in solidarity that none can exist unless all the rest surround it. All are so dependent on a single central reality that gives them their consistence and their unity.
At this moment, when your life has just poured with superabundant vigor into the sacrament of the world, I shall savor with heightened consciousness the intense yet tranquil rapture of a vision whose coherence and harmonies I can never exhaust.
Communion.
The fire has come down into the heart of the world to lay hold on me and to absorb me. Henceforth, I cannot be content simply to contemplate it. What I must do is to consent to the communion which will enable it to find in me the food it has come to seek. So, my God, I prostrate myself before your presence in the universe which has now become living flame. Beneath the lineaments of all that I shall encounter this day, all that happens to me, all that I achieve, it is you I desire, you I await.
What I want, my God, is that my terror in the face of the nameless changes destined to renew my being may be turned into an overflowing joy at being transformed into you.
I shall stretch out my hand without hesitation toward the fiery bread which you set before me. This bread, in which you have planted the seed of all that is to develop in the future, I recognize as containing the source and the secret of that destiny you have chosen for me.
We can never reach the blazing center of the universe simply by living more and more for ourselves, nor even by spending our lives in the service of some earthly cause, however great. To take this fiery bread, I know, is to surrender myself to forces which will tear me away painfully from myself in order to drive me into danger, into laborious undertakings, into a constant renewal of ideas, into an austere detachment where my affections are concerned.
My communion would be incomplete if I did not also accept, in my own name and in the name of the world, those processes, hidden or manifest, of enfeeblement, of aging, of death, which unceasingly consume the universe.
My God, I deliver myself up with utter abandon to those fearful forces of disillusion, which I blindly believe will cause me to be replaced by your divine presence.
Nothing, Lord, can subsist outside of you and your incarnation. Even those who have turned away from your love are still the beneficiaries of your presence upholding them in existence. All of us inescapably exist in you, the universal milieu, in which and through which all things live and have their being. Lord, teach us the true meaning of purity, not a debilitating separation from all creative reality, but an impulse carrying one through all forms of created beauty. Show us the true nature of charity, not a sterile fear of doing wrong, but a vigorous determination that all of us together shall break open the doors of life. And give us, above all, an increasing awareness of your presence and a blessed desire to go on advancing, discovering, fashioning, and experiencing the world so as to penetrate even further and further into you. For me, my God, all joy and all achievement, the very purpose of my being, and all of my love of life, all depend on this one basic vision of the union between yourself and the universe.
The kingdom of God is justice and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Come, Lord, and open in us the gates of your kingdom.
The kingdom of God is justice and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit.
Come, Lord, and open in us the gates of your kingdom.
Glorious Christ, you whose divine influence is active at the very heart of matter, and at the dazzling center where the innumerable fibers of the multiple meet. You whose power is as implacable as the world and as warm as life. You whose forehead is of the whitest of snow, whose eyes are of fire, and whose feet are brighter than molten gold. You whose hands imprison the stars. You are the first and the last, the living and the dead, and the risen again. It is to you whom our being cries out a desire as vast as the universe. In truth, you are our Lord and our God. Amen.
Come, Lord, and open in us the gates of your kingdom.
Come, Lord, and open in us the gates of your kingdom.